Do you know what a Japanese Kabuto Ari joint is? No? Stick around to find out. The Kabuto Ari joint is usually used in framing traditional Japanese buildings. The joint is used to connect the joists to the wall frames and often contains a slot where the rafter is attached to the frame. There is no need for mechanical fasteners when this joint is used because the dovetail locks the joint tightly in place. My interest in the joint is whether it can be scaled down and used in furniture making. I can't help wondering whether this type of joint will add another subtle feature to a piece of furniture. These are a couple of samples that I quickly made, so they're not as tight as I'd like, but they were enough to show that the joint could be used as a feature in furniture. Let's look at the male side of the joint. As you can see, the male side is basically a dovetail with a lip. The lip rests on the female part and supports the joint when the two parts are brought together. The dovetail does not extend the full length of the male part so that the female part is not weakened by removing too much wood. I have already created a board that represents the roofing joist and I'll use it to model the male part, which I'll do in two steps. One, remove all the waste necessary to create the full length dovetail, and two, shorten the length of the dovetail. I have made some changes to the way I model things in an effort to avoid the topological naming problem. I no longer import external geometry into a sketch because I find that doing so can make the model brittle. I now draw all sketch elements in a sketch utilizing a datum plane and use the origin as the reference for making sure they all line up. I have a video that explains the topological problem in more detail. I've linked to it in the top right corner and also in the description below. The datum plane needs to be created on the top face of the board. I'll do this by displaying the origin and then selecting the XY plane and then clicking on the datum plane tool and then once more I'll select the XY plane. The dimensions that I'm going to use for the joint are specified in the specification spreadsheet, which I'll quickly show you now. You can see that the height of the board is 50 mil, the board width is 50 and so on. With the datum plane, I'm going to now offset that half the thickness of the board in the Z direction. And I use a formula to do that. And that is specifications board height on 2 and then click OK. And we'll turn the origin off as well because we don't need that anymore. Setting the datum plane up like this may seem a bit convoluted, but its location is now defined parametrically. So I can change the thickness of the board and the datum plane moves with it. Removing the bulk of the waste is fairly straightforward. I'm going to use a pocket that also creates a dovetail. And I'm going to use a polyline tool to create the pocket representing the waste. So we'll click on the datum plane and we'll create a sketch that is attached to the datum plane. And now we will use the polyline tool to sketch the waste. Now, this is going to be a rough sketch for now, and it's not going to be fully constrained because in this instance, it doesn't really matter. The important dimensions, the width of the dovetail at its widest point, and that is defined in the spreadsheet along with everything else. And then we use the dovetail width for that. The widest point of the dovetail is symmetric around the origin line. So we'll set a symmetry constraint to do that. The height of the dovetail is also set in the specification spreadsheet, so we'll set its depth now. We want the baseline of the dovetail to be vertically aligned, so we'll do that now. And now we need to set the angles of the dovetails. In this case, we only need to do one because everything else is symmetric. So we set an angle constraint. Again, the angles are in the specification, but in this case, it's going to be 90 degrees minus that. And what I hadn't done is I hadn't made the baseline symmetric about the origin line as well. So let's do that now. And there is only one more dimension that we need to worry about, and that is the placement of this edge here from the center line. So we'll set a horizontal distance constraint for that. And again, that comes straight out of the specification spreadsheet. Board length on 2 minus the length of the lip. Dovetail offset. Not very well named, but that's what it should have been. That's the lip. So now we've got 4 degrees of freedom, but they actually have very little bearing on the sketch. We can now remove the waste that we don't need. So I'll close the sketch. Now I'll use the pocket tool to remove the waste. and we'll use a formula for that. And it's going to be the height of the board minus the height of the lip, which will make a dovetail that covers most of the board. And now what we need to do is we're going to reduce it in size. So we click on the datum plane, we create another sketch. And all we're going to do is do a rectangle like so. Its width is going to be the height of the dovetail. And we're going to align that with the base of the dovetail. When we did that in the original sketch, we did it from the long edge of the dovetail. So we'll do that again using a horizontal distance constraint. So that's the length of the board on 2 minus the dovetail offset. And the height of the dovetail doesn't matter because it is greater than the area that's being pocketed out. So we can close the sketch and just use the pocket tool again. And use the formula, the board height minus the lip minus the dovetail length. And we click OK. Turn off the datum plane. And now that is all modeled. Now we're going to look at modeling the female part. As you can see, the female piece has a dovetail socket and a mortise that provides additional support. I have already created a body representing the timber containing the female part. As usual, I will be creating the sketches on a datum plane, so we'll set that up. And it's going to be offset half the thickness of the board. We don't need the origin anymore. The first sketch that I'm going to create will remove the mortise. We select the datum plane, create a sketch, and this is all going to be relative to the center of the board. So I'll create a rectangle for the waist. It's going to be symmetric around the vertical center line. So we set a symmetry constraint. The width of the pocket is going to be the same as the width of the board, which comes from the spreadsheet, board width. And the position of the mortise is going to be also related to the board width. So we will set a vertical distance constraint, which is half the width of the board minus the depth of the mortise. I'm not going to constrain the final dimension because as long as the rectangle clears the model, then the pocket will remove all the waste that I want. So I'll close the sketch and then we'll use the pocket tool again. And the depth of the pocket will come from the spreadsheet, and that's the board height minus the height of the lip. Click OK, and that has the mortise done. Now I need to remove the waste for the dovetail. So we'll create another sketch, click on the datum plane. And we'll use the polyline tool to create the dovetail. And again, it's just going to be a rough sketch for now. The two horizontal pieces of the dovetail are going to be symmetrical about the origin. So we've put a symmetry constraint on. Similarly, we do the same for the top line. We set the length of the widest point using horizontal distance constraint. And the length comes from the spreadsheet. Dovetail width. We set the angle of the dovetail using an angle constraint. And again, that comes from the spreadsheet, and it's 90 degrees minus the dovetail angle. In this case, I've got it around the wrong way. It should actually have been 90 degrees plus. Now we need to constrain the base of the dovetail, just like we did with the mortise. And so we use a vertical distance constraint, and the values come straight out of the specifications. Board width on 2 minus the mortise depth. And the one other thing we haven't set, and I'll do that now, is the height of the dovetail. Again, we use a vertical distance constraint. And we'll pocket that to be the length of the dovetail. And turn off the datum plane. Now we've created both of the models. Let's assemble it. So I'm going to create a new document. I'm going to save that. I'll call that joint assembly. And I'll switch to the A2 plus workbench so that now I can do an assembly. So now I'm going to import the male and female parts. But before I do that, I need to make sure that they are both visible. If we go back to the parts file, we'll see that we've got the female part visible, but the male part isn't. So we just need to turn that on. So we select that, press spacebar, and now it's active as well. Looks a bit ugly in here, but that's okay. Then we go back to the joint assembly, and I'm going to use the add shapes from external file tool. Select the parts file, and I'm going to select both parts. And I'm just going to randomly assign them for the moment. Now I'm going to assemble them. So I'm going to select the base of the dovetail on the male part, and then I'm going to control click on the base of the dovetail on the female part. And then I'm going to use planes coincident constraint to make them coincident. Flip the direction and accept it. Now I'm going to select one face of the dovetail on the male part, and then we're going to rotate the model so I can control select the corresponding face on the dovetail in the female part. And I'm going to use the same constraint, make them coincident, and accept that. Now the final constraint is I'm going to select the front of the dovetail on the male part, and then select the corresponding face on the female part of the socket, and press the same constraint again and accept it, which brings everything together. Now, those of you who have watched some of my other videos have probably seen animations of the assembly coming together and apart. Don't think I've ever demonstrated how to create the animation, so I'll correct that oversight now. The animation at the start of the video was made using the process that I'm about to show you. So I'm going to use the exploded assembly workbench to do this. So I switch to that. Now, this is not going to be an in-depth demonstration. I'm planning to do a demonstration of the exploded assembly workbench in the not too distant future, so keep an eye out for that. But this demonstration will just simply show you what I do to make those simple animations. So by switching to the exploded assembly workbench, you can see that that's added a new group in the model. And to make the animation, all I'm going to do is move the male part in and out. So I select the top face of the male part because this is the direction that I wanted to animate. And then I use the Create Simple Group tool to create the animation. When I open up the simple group, there are some property values that we can change. The number of animation steps and the distance combined to make a 1 second animation. In this case, we have a distance of 20 millimeters and a step of 20. So that will move 20 times in 1 second. Changing the animation steps and the distance impacts how long it takes to run the animation. The animation steps define how fast the animation moves. Making the distance and steps equal produces an animation time of about 1 second. Decreasing the number of steps reduces the animation time by increasing its speed. Similarly, increasing the number of steps reduces its speed, increasing the time of the demonstration. I usually set the distance and animation steps to be the same to get a 1 second animation per animated part. This is done in the data tab for each animation. And in this case, I'm just going to change it to be 150 for both, just so you can see that it is working and that it takes a little bit of time. The Kabuto Ari joint is a fairly simple one to model. Do you think you could use the Kabuto Ari joint in furniture making? Tell me what you think in the comments below. Please click the like button if you like this sort of video. You can help me show others how they can use FreeCAD in woodworking projects by sharing the video or by buying me a coffee through the link in the description below. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.